Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. Got an exciting video for you today. We're gonna do a deep dive into handheld routers, one of my absolute favorite tools. The first thing you need to understand is we can divide routers into two primary categories, dedicated routers and general purpose routers. Dedicated routers are routers that we use that have a specific bit or setup that stays on the router all the time. So here on my workbench, I'm just gonna start pulling out all of the dedicated routers that I use all the time. You'll see I've got cordless as well as corded dedicated routers. Now, general purpose routers are routers that we're gonna be changing bits on quite a bit. They're routers that don't always have the same bit in them all the time. So here you can see I've got all of my different routers consolidated into this cabinet. So just on my workbench here, I have five routers that are dedicated routers. What that means is the machine is dedicated to a specific router bit and bit setup. So where is the line when we decide when are we gonna set up a router and just leave it set up all the time? As someone who makes money from using these tools, that is ultimately determined by what is the cost of the bit and router, and then what is the cost of my time every time I'm switching that. So you really just have to look at, okay, if I use the same 5/32nd roundover bit all the time, every day, I should probably just have a dedicated router for that. Because if I'm having to just, if I just have one individual router on my workbench and I'm switching this bit every time I need to use a different router bit, that becomes very inefficient and costly, and your money ahead by just buying an individual router, keeping the same bit set up in it all the time. And just a quick glance at what we've got here. This is my OF1010 set up as basically a lipping planer, which is a flush trimming bit with a nice guide out here. You've probably seen that on different videos. I've used this all the time. We've got our nosing set up right here. So whenever I'm doing shelf nosing, or if I wanna make a really flush joint, I'll hollow the edge on plywood before applying nosing. 5/32nd roundover bit, use that a ton just for easing edges. 16th inch roundover pilot bit. This is gonna be great for face frames. Use that all the time when building cabinets. And then a compression flush trimming bit, which is handy as well. This plunge base, I do tend to change bits in this whenever I'm doing miscellaneous tasks. I've taken some crappy comments over the years for how many routers that I have. I probably have about a dozen of these cordless DeWalt compact routers. We keep a couple on every work vehicle out in the field, as well as different routers that stay in different kits all the time. For example, my pocket door mortising hardware kit has two of these routers and plunge bases that stay with that kit all the time. The reason is it's a better investment to have those routers in that kit dedicated right there than to be hunting for routers and hunting for bits all the time. We keep the same bits set up in the routers. It's faster, makes us money, and makes our life easier that way. Before I pull all of these routers out and we talk about different types of routers, I want you to notice right here, I've got all of my routers and most importantly, my router accessories all together in this cabinet, all kind of in the same general area. That's extremely important. You're probably gonna end up owning a lot of different types of routers. They're gonna use different wrenches, different collets, different edge guides, different base plates. You need to keep all that stuff organized. As soon as you spend half an hour looking for your quarter inch collet for a particular router, you are throwing money down the drain. So try and keep your stuff consolidated and organized. Here I've got my collets organized by quarter inch, half inch, router type, as well as the router wrenches all vertically in line. So if I'm using a DeWalt router, I know to go right here to grab what I need. Miscellaneous router accessories down here, bushings, centering cones, router bolts and stuff like that for attaching bases, miscellaneous bases in here, and then all of my base plates are all together as well. Same thing for edge guides over here. Some routers are gonna come in a kit where you might get a fixed base and a plunge base as well as accessories. Sometimes it does make sense to keep things together in a kit. I do like to keep this kit here for my Festool OF1010 router in a kit with all the accessories because it's easy to grab and go. Same thing here with this Milwaukee mid-size cordless router, their new version. It's got a plunge base and a fixed base. It's great for grabbing and taking to the job site, so I like to keep that as a kit. However, I've got another kit here. I actually own a couple of these. This would be a DeWalt three-piece base kit. It's got the D-handle base, fixed base, and the plunge base. You'll notice it's empty because I just take everything out and I keep it in the cabinet here, and this case is over in my cold storage. Now it's time to talk types of routers. Pulled out all of my routers out of the cabinet, gave them a count here. I've got 15 routers, 15. Basically, I work by myself here in the shop, but I've got 15 routers just in this little area where I work. So why do we need so many routers and what are they all for? Now we can start by dividing routers into some different categories, broadly speaking. First off, we have cordless and corded. Here, we've got a compact corded router. Here, compact cordless router. Two different categories. We can also differentiate these by size. We have compact routers, we have mid-size routers, and then we have full-size routers. On this table here, you don't see any full-size routers. For me personally, the only truly full-size router that I own is in my router table. I believe this is a 3 1/4 horsepower Porter cable router. That works pretty well, but once we get to that size, then it makes sense to start moving up to a shaper. Now, after we differentiate for cordless, corded, what size of router, the biggest key difference between routers is going to be what type of base the router has. So here to show the difference between these different types of bases, I've got one of my all-time favorite routers, the DeWalt DW716. This is the exact same motor on all three of these routers, but it's changeable between these different bases that you see out front right here. So you can actually buy this router in a kit where you get the plunge base, the fixed base, and the D-handle base all in one kit. Adds a lot of versatility in the shop with just one router. So which router and which router base should I be using all the time? This seems really complicated, right? Well, the truth is there are no clear-cut lines that tell you I should always use a fixed base router for this task or I should always use a plunge base router for this task. Truth is, most of the time you can use either one, but the truth is also that most of the time one style of base is going to be better suited to a task than another. So here are some real quick general guidelines on how to kind of narrow it down to what's going to work best. This router, I've got my 1/4 inch spiral compression bit, which is a flush trimming bit. Why would I have this in a plunge base? Well, very simply because with this bit, I like to have a lot of control. I like to have two hands on the router whenever I'm using this bit. So with this one, I like to have a plunge base. Same thing right here. If I step up from this guy's big brother to this guy here, same thing. I've got two hands on a plunge base, gives me a lot more control. There are also a couple other key advantages with this. On this particular router, I've got a plastic dust shroud right here and a good dust collection port up here. The last time I was using this, I was doing a lot of mortises and it was making a ton of sawdust. So being able to hook up a hose to this and have good dust extraction was really nice. Now, if I'm using the fixed base router right here, everything is open. There's no dust extraction, so it doesn't work nearly as well and it makes a much bigger mess. Another key factor that's going to help me decide which style of base I want to use is how am I setting the depth of the router bit. With these two dedicated routers on my workbench here, these are basic roundover bits. So to set the depth, all I'm doing is popping the collar here and I'm twisting this to raise and lower the base. And all I've got to do to set the depth on this is to sight with my eye across the base until my base lines up with the top of the radius on the router bit. Very easy. It's by far faster to do this with a fixed base, and there's really no reason for me to want to have a big old plunge base on this type of bit situation. Same thing here with this little guy. If I'm setting the depth, you're just twisting the base to raise or lower it, using your eye to line it up. Piece of cake, no reason to have a plunge base on that. Now, plunge bases offer some really unique advantages that fixed bases do not. On any plunge base, you're usually gonna have a lever on the backside here, and what that's gonna allow you to do is plunge the base up and down. I'll move my guide rod up here. As you can see, I can move this base up and down now. That's gonna be handy if I'm making a mortise in the center of a piece of material and I've got a jig and I wanna be able to set my guide bushing down in the center of my jig and then drop this thing straight down. I can push it down, hit the stop, lock the lever down, and then do my routing operation. That's a really handy feature in a lot of different situations. For me, the real secret sauce to a plunge base is in this guy right over here. This is your depth stop. This is a really, really handy feature. So let's say I've set my bit to a certain depth right here, and I want to make it a quarter inch deeper. All I have to do is take my quarter inch depth gauge right here. I can lift the stop, put it in between there, press firmly, lock it down. I'm gonna pull that out of there. And now when I relieve my lever here and push all the way down, I'm exactly a quarter inch deeper. Let's do this operation with an actual bit installed. So here I've got a flush trimming mortise bit. And first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna zero this bit so that the bottom of the bit is flush with the base. So as you can see right here, I'm going up and down. I'm just gonna press it down until it touches down on my workbench. So now I know my bit is perfectly flush with the base, and you can even take a bar or a piece of material or something like that just to confirm that. But let's say I want this bit to be exactly a quarter inch deeper. Same thing. We'll now go over here to my depth rod, take my quarter inch spacer. I'm gonna drop it in right here, push it down firmly, lock it in place, remove my spacer carefully, and now I can loosen my handle, and when I push, I gotta go, whenever I push this down, I'm exactly a quarter inch deep, and I'll lock the handle down again right here. And then if we go over here, now you'll see when I place my depth stop up against the bit, I'm exactly a quarter inch deep. If I had to give you kind of a general rule of when you use a fixed base versus a plunge base, most of the time for me, if I'm doing a routing operation where I'm on the edge of material, it's typically gonna be better suited for a fixed base router. It's just a little bit easier that way. If I'm doing an operation where I'm using a jig and doing a mortise on the interior of a piece of material, then it's usually a little bit better to go with a plunge router. Just kind of depends. That being said, I could still totally chalk a mortising bit into a fixed base router and do this same operation. So there's just a lot of different ways to skin the cat with routers. The next key thing to understand with the anatomy of a router is the collet size. So what is a collet exactly? The collet is this piece right here. It screws on to the end of your motor assembly, and you're gonna insert your router bits into this collet and then tighten it down, and that's how you install a router bit. Pretty simple stuff. Now, with larger routers, you're gonna have the option to use different collet sizes. So here, I have a quarter inch collet, but maybe I want to use a little bit larger router bit with a half inch shank. I can change this out for a half inch collet, and now I can use router bits with a half inch shank, like so. Very easy to switch out. You just wanna make sure that you keep your collets all sorted out so it's easy to grab them and match them up with the correct router. Just to answer the question real quickly, like what's the difference between our quarter inch router bit shank and a half inch router bit shank? Well, there are certain router bits that are just impossible to make with a quarter inch shank. For example, this half inch spiral flush trim bit right here, you could not make this with a quarter inch shank. At least it couldn't be very strong. So it just needs to have a half inch shank. Here, a quarter inch spiral bit works perfectly having a quarter inch shank. So they're suited according to its size and what the bit is trying to do. Half inch shank bits are stronger and more stable. They vibrate less, but they are more expensive. Quarter inch shanks, they're smaller, lighter, less expensive, gonna vibrate a little bit more. And if you really got gnarly with them, you could even bend the shank or break it off. I'm not sure I've ever broken a quarter inch shank. I have bent them though. It is important to note that with your compact palm size routers, these usually only come with a quarter inch collet because they're sized to only be using quarter inch bits. So one disadvantage to the palm routers is that you can only use quarter inch bits with them. When you're installing a router bit, notice that there's only a little over an inch of space that actually grips down onto the shaft of the router bit. So there's really no point in going deeper than that, but you do wanna make sure that you've got enough of the bit inserted that it can get a good grip on it. I mean, you don't wanna stick the bit in and only have a quarter inch of it in there. That would be a little bit sketchy. So put enough of it in that it's gonna be able to tighten down and get a good firm grip on it. So to install the bit, you're just gonna put your collet on there, get it to the depth that you like, and then hand tighten it just with your hands. Most routers have a spindle stop on the side and that's going to engage. And then all you've got to do is take your wrench and snug it up. Doesn't need to be crazy tight. Just snug it up and that's good enough. It goes without saying, but as a standard practice in life, just always unplug the cord before you change your bit. These switches are on the side of the tool. You're trying to crank it around and stuff. It's possible you could have your hand on that bit and accidentally turn on the router. I know, I'm the same as everybody else. Countless times I've been on the job site, went to go change my bit and had the battery on here and thought to myself, I can still do it with the bit on there. But just a good practice, take the battery off as well on your cordless routers before you change your bits. When you go to put your router base back on, note that there is a channel going down the side on these routers. On your router base, you will have a couple of pins on the inside of the base. Those pins always have to line up with that channel to make your base go back on. So here, we're gonna do this one-handed or dare to. Here you'll note this notch sticking out on the side of the base. That indicates where these pins are at. That will help you line it up as you put your base on. If you don't get those lined up, your base is simply not gonna go on. And you're probably gonna scratch something up on the base. So line that up, you're good to go. Same thing over here. We've got our line right there. Look where our pins are at, right there. I find these compact router bases can be a little bit stubborn to get to go back on. Now we are on to our next extremely exciting part of the router anatomy, and that is the base plate of the router. Over here in my router cabinet, I've got a whole little tub dedicated to router base plates. It's extremely important that you have a variety of these because you're gonna need a variety of these. Now you will notice as we work our way around here, we have a variety of shapes and sizes of base plates on all of these different routers. You'll notice some of them have a very large cutout. That's gonna be what you're gonna need for really large router bits. These types of plates come in handy a lot of times, but they are very limited because you cannot install a guide bushing on a plate that has a huge opening like this. Many router base plates are gonna have a pre-machined area where you can drop in a guide bushing like so, and then your ring goes on the bottom there and you can then use this with templates. So you can see here, this is a very common setup. 1/2 inch mortising bit with 5/8 outside diameter guide bushing. That's extremely common right there. You'll notice here on this Festool router, this whole insert is removable, but it also has an area pre-machined. Holy cow, I'm trying to look through the camera and it is not working. There we go. Just gonna focus on that. Drops right in there like so, again, for using templates and such. Down here, we've got a shallow guide bushing installed. Now, if we look over here, this is what happens when you get stuck on a job site and you need to use a rabbeting bit, which is really wide, and you don't have the proper size plate. Ended up hacking that out with a jigsaw in order to make the bit fit. Right here, I've got 3 DeWalt compact routers. Now this is the plunge base, and it comes stock with this relief area to use a guide bushing. Over here, if you just buy the router with the fixed base, this is what you're gonna get. Notice it is not machined to receive a guide bushing, will not work. So what I usually do is I end up removing this base and I add a universal base. You'll see all these tons of holes all over this base. It'll fit a ton of different routers and then it gives you the ability to use a guide bushing. These are super handy to have around. In my box of router base plate goodness right here, I've got a lot of different base plates that I've taken off of routers. For example, these two both came off of DeWalt routers, and you can see they have that large cutout, which makes them pretty much worthless for anything except large router bits. I prefer to have a base plate that has the guide bushing mortise in it. So I like to keep a lot of these universal base plates in stock. You can buy them for the compact size routers as well as the full size routers. So yeah, I really recommend having those. Again, you know, here's another one of those DeWalt's compact router stock plates that I'll probably never use again. But having a variety of these is essential. The other thing that I recommend that you stock and have a variety of is guide bushings in 5/8 outside diameter. That's gonna be what you use almost all the time for templates. I recommend that you have shallow as well as deep. So this is a shallow 5/8 guide bushing. It does not stick up very high right here. If I come down here and I grab my compact router here, you'll notice I got a 1/2 inch bit and then a taller guide bushing on this. They're good for different situations. Now here is a lesson that has been hard learned for me. You'll notice this guide bushing has been completely destroyed and mangled. That's a bad day when that happens. When you install a guide bushing or a base plate on a router, there are 2 things that you must do. And please listen, because I've learned this the hard way too many times. You cannot get by, in my opinion, without doing this. You're gonna have your base plate. You're gonna have your guide bushing. You're gonna insert the guide bushing, and then what you're gonna wanna do is just thread on your other piece. You're gonna think, I'm really just gonna crank on it with a pliers and get it nice and tight, and it's never going to come loose. You would be dead wrong. The vibration of the router will make this come loose, and because the tolerance around your spinning router bit is so tight, if it moves ever so little, it's gonna dig in to that guide bushing, and you're gonna end up with a scenario like this. Before you attach a guide bushing, always put thread locker on the threads. And my mindset is, once I put a guide bushing on a base plate, it is permanently there. These two are eternally joined together in holy matrimony for the rest of time. They're not being separated ever again after that, but I can route with peace of mind knowing that I've got thread locker on these threads and that this baby is not gonna move. The other thing that you need to make sure you do, and what actually got me on this guy, was I did not have the screws on my base plate tightened down enough. And it wasn't actually the guide bushing that came loose whenever this got mangled, it was actually the plate rattled loose. And then I had a big old monster half inch spiral bit like this in there, and it got real ugly real quick. So if you're like me, whenever I was starting out, I thought, oh, I need to go out and I need to make sure I have every size of guide bushing in a nice lovely kit like this. Probably bought this 10, 15 years ago and have never touched it. The only guide bushing that I use in professional finish carpentry is a 5/8 outside diameter guide bushing. So if you're gonna spend your money, I recommend you just buy the individual guide bushings and rings. I keep an inventory of them all the time with the taller ones and the shallower ones, and that's all you really need. Same thing on your base plates. Go on Amazon, search for universal router base plates for compact router or mid-size router, and stock yourself up with a few of those and you'll be covered for whatever scenario you're gonna encounter. I'll also put links, as always, to this stuff in the video notes, the video description, as well as the top comment. So I get a kickback from that if you'd be so kind. All right, guys, I feel like we've covered a lot of ground. I think there's one more question I want to address, and that is, what router should I buy? So you see here, I actually have a lot of different brands, sizes, types of routers. What I'll tell you, the DeWalt compact cordless routers are fantastic for me in my workflow and what I do. Like I said, I think I own about a dozen of them. No regrets. They've all been great. They all still work just like new. As far as I can tell, I've been extremely pleased with the DeWalt cordless compact routers. Mid-size routers, I like the DeWalt DW618. And I also like the kit that comes with the D-handle base, the plunge base, and the fixed base. I think that's a great versatile kit if you wanna kinda get started and have a little bit of everything. Like I said, I've got three of these routers and two of those kits. Those have been good for me, no regrets there. I will say, I recommend that you pick a specific mid-size router and try and standardize that. Try and stick to that router as you keep adding routers, so that you have the same base plates, the same collets, the same wrenches, all the same stuff with that router. Otherwise, it just ends up being kind of a hodgepodge that's hard to keep straight. Festool routers are amazing. This is the OF1010. This is a dedicated router to flush trimming. This has been set up like this for several years. It's paid itself off several years ago. No regrets doing that. In general though, if you're gonna buy like an OF1400 like this one, they're fantastic routers, but they're expensive. They're not necessarily the best value. If I just had to take one router to a job site, this would probably be the one that I would take, but your money can be stretched out more going with more affordable options like the DW618 that I have here. So all in all, Bosch also makes some decent routers. I've got a few Bosch. I haven't had any problems with them. I've heard others have more problems with them. And then I do kind of regret, I have two kind of cheaper Porter cable routers back here that I bought. Just generic type routers, and they're kind of like bleh. I'd rather reach for one of these DeWalts if I'm gonna be doing something. But if you need to just dedicate a bit, like I've got this big old flush spiral bit dedicated to this router, it's a little bit more affordable to do it that way. We covered a lot of ground, guys. I feel like I'm tired of talking. I hope this video has been helpful to you in just getting a better understanding of routers from kind of a 1,000-foot perspective. Let me know your questions. We can go deeper on any of these different topics. Fixed base, plunge base, jigs, router bits, etc. Let me know what you want to hear more about, and I'll try and make the videos. So thanks for watching. Comment, like, subscribe, and check out those affiliate links, and we'll see you on the next video.